We got up before dawn just to bring you
Top of the Morning from beautiful downtown Baltimore.
Top of the Morning, Baltimore.
The top of the morning to all of you.
Top of the morning.
Dragon's breath and eye of newt, bubble, bubble, toil and trouble, hit and sing, witches, witches, witches on the wing. Watch the sky on Halloween. The strangest sight I've ever seen. Skin, warts and wrinkles and pointy chins, scary voices, scary hair, witches, witches, witches everywhere. Watch the sky on Halloween. Witches on the moon, the strangest thing I've ever seen. Watch the sky.
Hello, I'm Laurie Cabot. I'm the official witch of Salem, Massachusetts. I have been an open witch in this city, and the first open witch in this city, since 1967. I opened the first witch shop in America in 1971. And in 1973, I put on the first official witch's Halloween ball. It's called Samhain to us. It's our New Year's, and I put on a ball in the armory, and we had like 1,000 people there. Since then, of course, we have a community of witches in Salem. Families, men, women, children, and it has grown, and it is a lovely community. Salem, in some ways, has totally embraced us, and bring tourism, and there's nothing wrong with having tourism, but there's something wrong with not honoring the witches who live their lives as witches, and they're not there just on Christian Halloween. Our New Year is celebrated very differently than the way the rest of the world celebrates Halloween. And we may have a dance or a costume ball and a Feast of Morgan where we sit down and have a beautiful feast and listen to Celtic harp music. And our witch's ball, we don't allow green faces, no vampire teeth, and no horns and red union suits with a pitchfork. We make them take them off as they come in the door. So what we do at our witch's ball is dress So our witch's ball is very different than what goes on here. And there are several people in this area who will call themselves witches who are not, simply to come out in October on the 31st or in that area to make money and become psychic and become witches. And they might throw a party, and they would have the whole kit and caboodle. They'd have the green faces, and they would have all the scary axe murderers or whatever people run around and do. We feel that that's not a good projection for the new year. We feel that if you dress like that, you're apt to bring that into your life. And so we dress up like, maybe you want to dress up in a very rich way, or become beautiful and be a butterfly or a fairy. There are many ways of projecting yourself into the new year. I think that our new mayor, being a woman, I think that's wonderful and miraculous. I love seeing that. I don't really know her now, and I don't know if she knows the real community here, which is quite large. Last night we had Ostara. Ostara is where the word Easter came from. Of course, it's pre-Christian, and Ostara is a German goddess, a Celtic goddess, and she's depicted always with a rabbit at her feet and an egg in her hand. And last night we had 66 people from this community dancing in a circle at Winter Island in the little hall they have there that we rent, and playing drums and singing music and honoring the change of the season, spring. And we put beautiful seeds on our altar, and we charge the seeds, and everyone takes a handful home so they could start planting. And this time we did sunflowers. We're going to plant sunflowers all over Salem. And I think it's wonderful. And our new mayor, I don't think she realizes who we are, what we do, and that's not all about being commercial. It's not all about having a witch shop, which I have. And I started my witch shop because I had made a vow to wear my robes and not take them off. I wanted to honor the goddess and let everybody know that I was a witch 24/7. Well, I didn't realize by doing that I couldn't work at IBM or in the bank. So I said, well, maybe I should open a shop and it'll be a teaching unit. People will learn more about herbs and about what witches do, and I could put a roof over my head and my children. And so that was the first witch shop in America. And now we have many. We have so many witch shops. I think it's absolutely fascinating and wonderful. And I wonder if our new mayor has ever been in a witch shop and seen what really goes on, all the beauty and all the wonderful things in these shops. They're not dark and ugly. They're not, you know, we might wear a pointed hat once in a while, but it's really not the fashion. We do wear our capes. And we wear our robes on holidays mostly, but most witches dress like everyone else and work in the bank. They work, you know, I go to my bank to take my money in from the store, and there's one girl behind one of the tellers, and she says, "Blessed be," and she's wearing a pentacle. I wonder if the mayor knows that. And on, you know, we're in this community. I'd love to have a sit with her. I'd love to have a cup of tea and talk to her, because she is a woman in power, and it's wonderful. But I'd like her to be aware of her community and the supportive energy of witches. Witches have a goddess. We have a god and a goddess. So we would respect her probably more than any other group in Salem. And we probably would support her decisions of equality in this community. And I would love to have a talk with her. As you can hear, there's a little bit of a ruckus here. That's because we're in my store. The Cat, the Crow, and the Crown. Lori Cabot's Witch Shop. And of course, there's quite a few people in here today, so I'm sort of talking over the crowd. Absolutely. We started the Witches Public Awareness League. I started that. We put together, one of the witches was a paralegal, and we put together the law memorandum. And our law memorandum has all the federal and the state laws of civil rights. And we have a case working that proves that witchcraft is recognized by the federal government as a religion. And I am a high priestess. I marry people legally in this state, all rites of passage. And there are many witches here in Salem who do the same. But before that time, the fire department, the police department, the chief of police, and any authority in Salem had no idea that it was a legal religion, that we had civil rights. And they ignored that. They just thought it was kind of funny, everybody's trying to be a witch. Until they got the law memorandum, once they got the do's and don'ts of witches, which is a flyer or pamphlet that I produced, and the law memorandum, then they realized they needed to protect us like they protect every other religion in this town. And since then, that has been the case. What happens, though, is that as the years have gone on, new people have taken places in high positions who do not know. So we've fired up the WPAL again, and we're sending out the packets to everyone in our city, but we have a new perspective about our rights, and we are sending those packets to every city in Massachusetts, every city and town, and to Washington, D.C. We've already started sending the packets to Washington to let them know that we're here and that we deserve our civil rights. And I think that because our way of life, we call it a religion, but it's also a way of life, recognizes the balance between feminine power and masculine power. It's equality. And we have so many witch families in this community and around the globe that purport that and also act upon that. It needs to be known. And I think the Witches Public Awareness League allows that to be known. We write articles for papers in our own communities, allowing them to know how we celebrate and how we live our lives. Very important. At one time, my coven and I helped children with special needs. It was our duty, and we took it on as a project, supplying clothing and et cetera to children who needed it. Governor Dukakis recognized that, and he used to give out a Patriots Award, and he signed it personally. And the Patriots Award said, "I proclaim Lori Cabot, the official witch of Salem, Massachusetts, for her work with children with special needs." And the Patriots Award said, "I can graze cows on the common," in Boston, that is, and that I could wear a tri-cornered hat. I thought that was marvelous. And it was very nice of him, actually. I've written 4 books. Power of the Witch was the first book, and it was sort of a coverall, you know, but it was from my heart and written in my own voice and my own language, and it's been printed around the globe. I've had people walk up to me with a book written in Russian and ask me to sign it, and I said, well, gosh, I can't even read that, can I? I hope I remember what's in it. That book definitely was from my heart, and the gratification comes when people said, every word you said sounded like something I have said or thought in my life, and now I know I'm a witch too. And that makes me feel so good that they find their path or they find their way. I wrote Love Magic. I'm not so sure I like that book very much. I wrote Celebrate the Earth, which is about our 8 holidays, and I absolutely love that book. It went out of print. It's being reprinted now, which is really wonderful. And then The Witch in Every Woman, which every woman and every man should read. And it's about the power of women and their place in society and in the world. And it's based on Celtic mythology. And I don't know if you realize that the Celtic women were equal to their men. Pliny said, and in history, you can read it, he said, don't ever make don't go after a Celt because he'll call his woman. And then you'll feel the blows that you've never felt before. So I guess we were warriors at one time, weren't we? There's a door that we made one wall of the store is a cottage, and the door is 100 years old, and the window frames that are on that wall make it look like a cottage, and it they're 100 years old, and we put a pentacle, an emblem of witchcraft and protection, on the door. It's very charming, and we have a tree in our store. The front of the store is autumn. So we have an autumn tree, and we have all sort of autumn and fall things. As you go along, then it becomes spring, and you go through the store towards the back, and then there's summer, and then there's winter over in a corner, and it stays winter year-round. So we have all the 4 seasons in this store. We enjoy that because we base a lot of our magic on the changing of the seasons. We have 8 holidays a year, and every holiday is a change of the seasons. So you must stop and observe where you are and where you've been, and then celebrate. And that's what we do in summer, spring, you know, spring, summer, winter, and fall. We do it all. I would like to welcome you to The Cat, the Crow, and the Crown, my witch shop. We are at 63R Wharf Street in Salem, Massachusetts, and our phone number is 978-744-6274, and we have a website. It's lauriecabot.com, and welcome. We try very hard in this store to bring the magic. So a lot of the items in the store I make myself. I make my own potions. I make my own incense. I make books of shadows and spell bottles that are quite powerful. And we have other witches who make talismans and amulets and jewelry. I find that we need the magic to be real, not come from a vendor somewhere and make-believe incense. I think we need to put the real herbs and the real oils and the real magic into this store. At one time, I was on an airplane every week going from city to city, state to state, to do television shows, and it was quite interesting. I used to go to Maryland, and Oprah Winfrey was a young girl, and she had a partner with a talk show down there on Channel 13, would you believe? Called People Are Talking, and she had a host with her who is still on that show, And I think she said to me the third time I was on, she said to me, "Well, you're psychic. Tell me," she says, "when am I going to have my own show?" And I said, "About 10 years from today." "Oh, I don't want to hear that," she said. I said, "Around 10 years from today, or during that 10 years, at the end of that 10 years, you'll have your own show." She didn't want to hear that at all. And guess what? She has her own show, and it took about 10 years from that date. I think she was around 18 years old when I met her. Her hair had just been burned off by somebody who had done a perm or something on her hair. It was very short. And then I ended up doing her show in Chicago years later. It was quite interesting show. And at that time, Oprah was doing much like a talk show, and it was sort of like National Enquirer on air. And after I did the show, because she had a supposed Satanist and a Christian person and then me as a witch, and of course it was melee, and I don't like joining in on that kind of thing. So I kind of wrote her a letter right after that saying, you know, this is not what you do well, and it seems like the National Enquirer. I had a feeling that that letter was a little bit scathing that I sent her, and right after that she changed. And I think she was doing better work even than her father. Her father was a minister. And I think her work has gone well beyond that. Well beyond that. She's doing what she should have done. And she's putting together spiritual energy for the world. And I give her a lot of credit for that. I've been on, you know, NBC, ABC, CBS. I've been in London on every television show, BBC, Germany, Belgium, you know. I was on the Gay Byrne show in Ireland years ago. It was late show with the Rolling Stones. I was on a children's show with Kiss one time, the band Kiss. I thought that was quite interesting. But by doing all these shows, it has been a blessing somewhat to the craft, because it gave me a chance by which to explain who and what we are and what we are not. So I think that was a very good thing. I was asked to go on David Letterman and I refused. And at the time I had just had my first book published, and my publisher was jumping straight up and down and very angry with me. But I felt that I didn't want to try to represent every witch in the world and or have him make fun of witchcraft, because I thought that was not fair to other witches, so I refused to go on his show. Yes, I the history here of the witch trials, it's very compelling. It's also very confusing, because we have the theory of ergotrate causing the children, the girls who had fits and pointed at people and accused them of witches, that was the cause, and yet it might be a political reason because they had the wrong definition of the word witch. How could you find one if you can't define it? It was defined by another religion, meaning devil worshiper, an ugly old hag, you know, someone who does evil and magic. Well, you wouldn't find a witch that way, because they don't do that. We don't believe in a devil. We don't have one. We don't do evil. We're actually really quite afraid of doing evil, because we believe in a threefold law. Everything you do comes back to you threefold, and I certainly wouldn't want to live with that. And the other law we have is do what you will and harm none. And that's hard to do, you know, that's if you think about it. So we have very strict laws about doing good. That wasn't true in the definition that they had in 1692 or in the 1600s. Or 10 years prior to that in Europe, when they hung, that, you know, during that time period, over maybe 20 years, they hung maybe 9 million people burned and hanged, mostly women and children. So when it came to America, It was a political issue, and it still could be today. However, we're in America now. This is the Constitution, and we live under the Constitution, and we have the rights of every other religion, and we can speak about who we are. We don't have to hide.